Good evening all, I'm Aditi Lamba with the Tuesday night edition of South Asian News. Welcome to Vision of Asia, voice of our community. We are coming to you from our studio located in New York City. Here's what's happening tonight in the coronavirus pandemic. Globally, the coronavirus cases have surpassed a sobering number of 20.1 million with at least 737,000 deaths. Health officials believe the actual number is much higher. The United States, India, and Brazil are accounting for nearly two-thirds of all cases. In the United States, we are looking at 5.1 million cases of COVID-19 and more than 163,000 deaths. The nation is by far the worst affected country in the world. States California, Florida, and Texas continue to be surging with cases as the new hotspots of this disease. California currently has the highest number of COVID-19 cases, followed by state Florida. Both states have now surpassed New York, which was once the epicenter. Just today, California reported at least 12,500 coronavirus cases, bringing the state's total to more than 574,000. The World Health Organization has stated that more than 100,000 cases are being reported daily in the Americas. Half of them are in the United States. The WHO also showcased worry on spikes happening in countries that have had outbreaks controlled. There has also been a 90% increase in the number of cases among children over the past 4 weeks. This is happening as the nation focuses on safety issues and reopening of the schools for fall. College football teams are also debating postponing their seasons due to COVID-19. If you are a South Asian parent or an educator, send us your views on schools reopening. And if you are sending your child back to school, write to us on events@itvgold.com. Also, a call out for medical professionals to connect with us on your experience, your story on the front line. We look forward to continue presenting members of the community who are working tirelessly and contributing back to COVID-19 relief. And in U.S. politics and race for presidency, Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden today announced Senator Kamala Harris as his choice for vice president, making her the first Black and South Asian American woman of a major party presidential ticket in U.S. history. More on that tonight on the show, along with our ongoing updates and measures on COVID-19 featuring medical professional. Here are the headlines. Journalist Sri Srinivasan addresses U.S. elections 2020 and racial strife, New York City. Dr. Tushar Patel on surging COVID-19 cases in the nation, measures and updates, New Jersey. Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs and New York City Census 2020 host community and ethnic media virtual roundtable on state of 2020 census. A lot more on the other side of the break. Stay with us on Vision of Asia, voice of the community. We'll be back shortly. Welcome back. I'm Aditi Lamba and this is Vision of Asia, Tuesday night episode of South Asian News. Big news coming in this evening. Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden today announced Senator Kamala Harris as his choice for vice president. She is the first Black and South Asian American woman on a major party presidential ticket in the U.S. history. A great moment of pride for members of both the African American and South Asian community residing in the nation, wherein Senator Kamala Harris, former Vice President Joe Biden, gains a deeply experienced politician who has already been battle-tested in her own run for the White House, bringing in much courage and energy for the final stretch of the November 3rd elections. Bringing much on this and the role of South Asian and minority community in the U.S. elections, we spoke with well-known journalist Mr. Sri Srinivasan. Here is what Mr. Srinivasan had to say about Democratic vice presidential nominee Kamala Harris and his take on politics during a time of pandemic and racial strife. What are you closely following up this week? There's a lot happening in the nation. There's a lot being debated upon. But what are some things that we need to focus on in this week?
Well, I'm paying close attention to what's happening with the elections. We're about 85 days to go till the election, but it's actually a lot sooner than that because people are going to start voting in advance where you have mail-in ballots, which are subject of a lot of contention right now. But all of that's going to come a lot sooner than we think. November 3rd is much closer than we think, so I'm paying close attention to that. And here in New York, we are paying close attention to what happens with schools opening. I think in many ways, our community in New York paid an enormous price in March, April, May, and June. And now we are in slightly better shape than the rest of the country, but we're seeing what can go wrong with terrible management across the country, and those places that didn't lock down or lock down and open too soon. So great worry in terms of the election and great worry in terms of the pandemic.
Yes, for sure. In terms of, you know, the candidate for the Democratic Party for the presidential election, since we are talking about elections here.
It's Kamala Harris. There's going to be extra attention paid to by our community and people of color all over, because not just Black Americans are going to care, but also Indian Americans and Asian Americans. Asian Americans are the fastest voting, growing voting bloc in the country, and to have them extra engaged in various states, battleground states, is going to matter in places like Ohio, places like Michigan and Pennsylvania and other places. So
a nomination for VP who is a person of color, what do you think is reflected from that?
I think it's a reflection of the reality of today. The tragedy of George Floyd's killing has been that one of the aftermaths of that has been that there's increased awareness of the ways in which this country has done a real disservice to people of color for centuries, not only with enslavement, but also in how the country made up for that or tried to make up for that. In many ways, it didn't bother at all. And nominating a person of color in that slot, and this time it would be, obviously, if it's a person of color, be a woman of color, is a big deal. And I think it'll give people who have felt that the Democratic Party after President Obama hadn't done enough to pay real attention to the needs of the African-American community will be able to step up. After all, the fact that Joe Biden is the nominee is in part because of African-Americans supporting him and being there for him through the nomination process. And so there is a kind of debt he owes them. And we should also say that Black women in this country have been the most steadfast supporters of the Democratic Party in the last several elections. And they're the reason that even though the Democrats have done badly in some of the races, the reason that they're in charge of the House of Representatives, for example, is because of Black women for the most part.
You know, in terms of looking at this racial strife that is happening in the nation and also the issue of police brutality, since we are talking about the African-American community here right now, what have you felt personally as a journalist reporting on these issues as somebody who's also a minority person? And how do you look at this racial strife in the community, in the nation right now?
I think that this has been a reckoning that's taken way too long. The pandemic has done many things, but this is one of the things it's done is highlighted all the ways in which this country has been unfair to people of color, and especially African Americans, Native Americans. I can tell you that I run a daily program around COVID-19 and covering it in many, many ways, and I hadn't done an episode or even talked about Native Americans in any significant way until episode number 145 or so, 145 days into the pandemic. It just tells you the blind spots that we all have, and that it's important for us to understand that this country has been very good to Indian Americans, South Asians in many, many ways, and that we are here on the backs of the work put in by Latinos, Chinese Americans, African Americans, Native Americans, and we need to be, as a community, much more engaged in the fight for racial justice. One of the things that I have noted is that many Indian Americans who, as you know, come here either for, you know, they originally came here for their graduate studies or came here on an H-1B visa and started working, they never got the education about what this country's true background is and why it is that it's a special thing that many people were able to walk into engineering jobs at leading corporations. I maintain one of the most accurate lists of Indian Americans who are in charge of global corporations. And you look at that, it's a stunning list, you know, where whether you're looking at Adobe or Microsoft or Google or Albertsons, one of the big chain stores, grocery stores in America, and the list goes on, and the Gap, for example, right? All of these incredible organizations, companies run by Indian Americans, we benefit from being overeducated, and even while we acknowledge that there are South Asians in this country who have enormous poverty that they deal with and other issues, we have believed our own hype about being the most successful, the most accomplished, the highest educated. All of this we believe, even as in this country, even during the so-called good days, when the economy was roaring, we had a large percentage of Indian Americans our biggest cities who were unemployed, underemployed, and going hungry. So we need to acknowledge our role in benefiting from the history of America, and then we need to do our part to help America as we all go on to the next step in this process.
Looking at the U.S. Census 2020 now, we have highlights from a virtual roundtable organized by the New York City Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs and the New York City Census 2020. This was an emergency public session in response to President Trump's cutting of the door-to-door knocking period of census by 1 month, a move which may impact billions of dollars for critical programs as well as congressional representation for the next 10 years. Just a reminder, New Yorkers, regardless of country of origin, background, or immigration status, can self-report to census online at my2020census.gov. There are no questions about citizenship or immigration on the census. Here is what New York City Census 2020 Deputy Director Amit Singh Bagga and Chaya CDC lead organizer Jagpreet Singh shared about the census and our responsibility.
Why is the census important? You know, I know many of you at this point are familiar with the census, you know what the census is, you have a concept of what the census is, but the census is really so much more than just a count of every single person that happens every 10 years. It is the very foundation of our democracy. It is the basis on which every city and state across the country, including here in New York City, we get the money, the power and the respect that we are constitutionally guaranteed by the Constitution. $1.5 trillion in federal funds that the federal government distributes every single year for schools, hospitals, health insurance, affordable housing, roads and bridges, job training, youth programs, senior centers, Medicaid, Head Start, dozens and dozens and dozens of programs that our families rely on every single day. All of that money, the distribution of those funds, is based on the census. Simply put, the federal government takes a look at where the people are, how many they are, and on that basis distributes the funds. In addition to that, the census is the basis on which power, particularly power in the House of Representatives in Congress, is distributed across the 50 states. Every 10 years, after everyone in the country is counted, Congress goes through a process where it takes the 435 seats, that is a fixed number of seats that exist in the House of Representatives, which is the lower house in Congress, and they redistribute all of those seats across the 50 states based on the census figures. So what this means is that if you have an incomplete census, if not everybody in a particular place is responding to the census, that state, that city is going to lose representation in Congress. And that is critically, critically important. It's critically important every day, every week, every month, every year, but it could not be more important for New York City right now. Why? Because as you're seeing in the headlines every single day, Congress is the place where the majority of the important decisions about what our recovery and relief from COVID-19 is going to look like are being made. The extent and size of our unemployment benefits, whether or not small businesses are going to continue to get relief, any extensions of health insurance or social services programs specifically as a result of COVID-19, all of those decisions are being made in Congress. And right now, because New York City has just about a 54% census self-response rate, we stand to lose not one, but up to two seats in Congress, which means the power that we have as a city to stand up for ourselves, and not just people who are citizens, not just people who were born here, but the power that we have to represent every single New Yorker, no matter where they are from, no matter what language they speak or religion they practice, that power will be robbed from us if we do not participate in the census.
We're still seeing a massive undercount in many respects. While the overall numbers in America might be in the 60s, there are still census tracts in Richmond Hill which are in the 30s. And this is upsetting because we saw that back in 2010, Richmond Hill likewise had a very similar undercount as what we're seeing today. And we see the impacts of that today. As folks may know, we experienced a tropical storm yesterday. And even today, more than 24 hours after the storm has subsided, there are parts of Richmond Hill that don't have electricity. There are parts of Richmond Hill where entire streets are closed down because trees have fallen, because we don't have the infrastructural ability to trim them, to fix the infrastructure. There are parts of Richmond Hill that have overcrowding in the schools. And all of these are impacts that we felt from the census, whether it's the fact that we haven't seen a Indo-Caribbean elected official because we don't have any majority Indo-Caribbean districts because of the undercount within that community, whether it's the fact that the Punjabi community is split amongst four different assembly districts, three different council districts. All of these things are impacts that we have felt from the undercount back in 2010. Now, the biggest question I often get asked is why does this undercount exist within the South Asian, within the Punjabi, within the Indo-Caribbean communities? And there are many reasons why. First and foremost, you know, and something Amit had brought up before and others have talked about is that there's a prevalence of informal housing within South Asians. We have people who live in basement apartments, people who live in room shares and other sorts of accessory dwelling units, which make it much harder to count, which make it much harder to get the information out there. And we also have the fact that the census is not in any of our languages. It's not in Punjabi, it's not in Bangla, it's not in Hindi. It's not accessible in many ways to our community, but there's a much more insidious reason as well, right? Currently, we are out 4 to 5 times a week in the streets, ensuring that we're helping folks fill out the census. We're going to as many of the gurdwaras and temples within South Queens as we can, and we want to ensure that everybody gets their count up. And that is our goal at the end of the day, and we're grateful for all of our partners across the city, but we need all the help we can get in Queens as well. So if you do want to volunteer in South Queens, please feel free to hit us up at chayacbc.org or give us a call, which you can find on our website.
It's time for the short break. Stay with us in Vision of Asia, Voice of the Community. We'll be back shortly. And welcome back. This is Vision of Asia, the South Asian news segment, and I am Aditi Lamba. We are looking at the coronavirus pandemic's impact, measures, and updates, featuring top health experts and officials to bring forth relevant and credible information on the spread of this virus. Cases are surging across the south and west of the country, with California, Florida, and Texas showing a great number of cases. State of Florida is again reporting a record number of coronavirus-related deaths, and looking at it nationally, about 1,000 people are dying each day in the nation from coronavirus. Along with that, there is also an increase in demand for testing of asymptomatic individuals who wish to return back to their work or college. But what does returning back or reopening really mean? And how should we process the increasing number of deaths in the nation? We spoke with expert Dr. Tushar Patel, who again urged all to follow the guidelines, wear a mask, and practice social distancing. Here is Dr. Tushar Patel. Dr. Tushar Patel, thank you so much for being with us on ITV Gold. I hope you're doing well.
Thank you so much for inviting me again.
Of course, we got to get our doctors here to discuss with us what's happening with COVID-19 and all the updates and measures that we should take. Just starting off this interview, I have to ask you, we're right now looking at about 5.1 million cases in the United States with at least 163,000 deaths. About 1,000 people are dying each day from COVID-19. What should we process from this, and where do we go from this?
So, Aditi, as you know, when I came in June earlier, about 2 months ago, I predicted this, that some of the states are opening too soon without that 14 days downward trajectory. Example, California, Texas, Colorado, Florida, Arizona, Indiana, Illinois. Many states are in trouble because they did not follow the guidelines of reopening or rephasing the situation with pandemic. And I think the reason we are getting this many cases is that early opening of the states.
I'd also like to now take any comment or information you may have about the vaccine we're hearing from Russia the news was declared today. Any comments on that?
So Russia came with when we had the outbreak of Ebola, and unfortunately that did not work well. So I have mixed feelings about that, and I don't have trust on any other country for the vaccination except United States, where we have a strict control measures, efficacy, safety, and ensure that the vaccine is safe to given to all people in this country. So let's wait. I would not give credit to anyone at this point until we hear from our experts in FDA that we have, or NIH, that we have a vaccine which is effective and which can save lives when we have it end of this year or early next year.
Do you think they have come out with this vaccine way too early?
I think so, because like I said before, it takes about 4 to 6 years for the vaccine. So if you don't have those clinical trials, phase one, phase two, phase three, and in phase three, you need to have enrolled thousands and thousands of people to ensure that each and every one received the vaccine, waited for 14 days, 20 days, 3 weeks, to ensure that its efficacy is good, 60-70%, and the safety is the most important factor, because you don't want to get complications from the vaccine. So it could be definitely an issue if we have those kind of vaccines available right now.
Dr. Patel, what is your personal focus for the next couple of weeks?
I think next couple of weeks, we need to ensure that we take the common sense approach which we have been talking since March. If you are in the public places, you need to wear masks. You need to wash your hands. If you're sick, stay home. Don't go anywhere. And I think if it's possible, this is already middle of August now, if it's possible, postpone all your public gatherings, all the parties, all your graduations, all your birthdays. Right now, it's no time to do those kind of things. And especially our seniors. They shouldn't be participating in any kind of events, any public gatherings, indoor or outdoor, because I think that will definitely save us in the long run.
I would love for you to give out a message, actually, to all these South Asian frontliners that are working so hard every single day. I know it's been a task on the medical community. I would love for you to just reach out to them.
I salute them. I have so much respect, and I have so much feeling for them, because they have sacrificed their lives, and I have personally lost so many of my good friends in this battle. And all the frontline workers, healthcare workers, law enforcement officers, all the grocery workers, all people who doesn't have a choice but to go to work, I have a message for them that we are with you. Whatever we can do for you, may God bless you and keep serving this country and this community.
And that is all for tonight's show. Remember to send us a suggestion and get your voices and organizations on our show. Email us on events@itvgold.com or follow us on Facebook at @itvgold. You can also now subscribe to our YouTube channel to watch many of our popular shows for free. Thank you for joining us from Queens, New York. This is Vision of Asia, and I am Aditi Lamba. Take care and be well.